Welcome to Qt Widgets and More. In this episode, I'd like to take you on a journey that I went through myself. It almost felt like I moved from being a C hacker to a C++ developer to a modern C++ developer. Stay tuned to learn more. So in the previous episode, I told you to not use Booleans as parameters in your functions all the time. In this episode, I'll tell you to not always think of classes and especially class hierarchies as a default construct for stuff that you'd like done. Let me start out by showing you my very earliest starting point for this problem. I have this method createChart for setting up a KD chart. And in this chart, I was given a diagram, and on that diagram, I wanted to put some axes on the left, right, top, and bottom. And the axis would either be a normal axis or a euro axis, so an axis showing euro sign next to the numbers, or no axis. And then I would call on the setup method here, setup with a diagram and then a charting position, which was what KD chart expected, and then the axis here. So at the left, I would set up a left, either a normal or a euro or none. On the right, same thing, and so on. And it looks like this up here. So based on the configuration here for this given axis, I would either be calling add normal axis or add currency axis on my diagram. And my diagram class, very simple cut down version for this example here, simply add normal axis prints out adding a normal axis at this position. And for the euro axis, what's it, currency axis, adding currency axis with symbol, so the euro sign, for example, at this position. And my position is, I can print them out like this. That worked out very well until the day where I actually needed to specify a different currency. So you saw that I had the currency axis, but it actually was just called euro axis. But then I wanted to have dollar on my currency, so British pound or Danish kroner or something else. So I needed to encapsulate the euro sign into the element. So I thought, how would I do that? Well, I could just, instead of giving the enum, I could give a struct presenting what it was. And hey, I'm not that much of a C hacker, so I made it a class. It looks like this. So that's a few different changes compared to the previous one. First of all, I have this class axis, which has the position inside it. So instead of providing four parameters, I simply provide a list of axes, and given that they are, that the position is inside it, I don't need to specify left, right, bottom, and top, but can just give a list with these positions. The other thing is that my axis is subclassed into normal axis and currency axis, and you can see that my currency symbol here is inside there, which means that my setup method that you saw from before taking the axis now simply call diagram at normal axis if it is a normal axis. I can test that with a dynamic cast here. If it's a currency axis, again, a dynamic cast, then call the add currency axis with the currency symbol and the position that was in that object. I needed, for my dynamic cast to work, I need at least one virtual method, which is why I have a virtual destructor up here. Otherwise, it would say, hey, there's nothing virtual about this class, so even though you're subclassing, you can't do dynamic cast. And to be a good citizen, I have this initializer list. That's a list of elements. I have that with unique pointers in there. So no bare pointers in my code now. And it looks terrible, std initializer list with std unique pointers on my axis. But basically what I just have is a list of axes. And I run through that and call setup. And my method for setting up looks like this now. Create chart, my diagram, and here's my initializer list. And I call make unique on with normal axis for bottom and top, and for currency axis, specifying these parameters. At this point, I felt pretty good about myself. I managed to encapsulate the data inside an object and give it to the class, but of course, code review, a coworker came around and said, why don't you just have a virtual method for setting this up? So here's the next instantiation of this code. In this next version, I have a virtual void setup method on my axis, and It's a pure virtual method. There's a normal access that doesn't, well, it does do something, of course. It calls diagram add normal access. Then there is the currency one, which calls diagram add currency. And my create method, as before, taking this list of things, doesn't even need the setup method anymore. It simply called the setup method on each of those axes, and the calling looks the same. At this stage, I felt really, really good about myself. Obviously, I didn't have that old C legacy way of thinking of structs, but had a virtual method in it. And another code review, one of my coworkers was saying, why actually do you have those classes? All you need is the functions in there. So all the additional class hierarchy and the initializer list of your unique pointer, that ugliness, all of that, why do you have that? All you need is the method for each of those. So I thought, what do I have in my toolbox? Of course, I have std function and I have a lambda expression. So how about creating a method that is exactly just the setup method and it returns what I need? Let me show you what the end result looks like. And the end result is just mind-boggling beautiful. So I have this using setup function equal to std function. It's a function that takes a diagram pointer and returns nothing. So that's the setup function. And then I have another function returning that function, namely a function called normal access. It's a pretty weird name for a function starting with a capital letter. Maybe we should have called it get normal access. One of my coworkers was arguing very much about that, but as we'll see further down, I like just calling normal access. It takes the chart position and it returns this function here, which given a diagram, just call add normal access. Exactly what my setup function in the virtual setup function previously did. I also have my currency axis. It takes the symbol, it takes the chart position, and it returns this lambda expression again with the symbol and position being captured. And given a diagram, it will call diagram add currency, returns this setup function. My chart simply now takes an initializer list of setup functions, and it runs through each of those and calls the function that is returned by the setup function. And here's the beautiful part of it all. Please do enjoy line 29. It doesn't get any better than that. Create chart, and here's an initializer list for that. Normal axis at the bottom, currency axis with euro sign on the right, and a normal axis at the top. And that's why I didn't like to rename them to get normal axis, because then this wouldn't read as beautiful. But hey, that's potato potato, really. The key thing is rewriting it into a function, returning a function, something that is growing on me and has been doing that ever since I got introduced to lambda expressions back in 2011. Okay, I admit, not groundbreaking, maybe not even applicable to your code, but nevertheless, do review the code again and do make sure that you entirely understand everything about the function which returns a function part. And maybe next time you do a code review on your code, think about, could we do without all these elaborate hierarchies of inheritance? I'm Jesper Pedersen. You've been watching Qt Widgets and More. And do remember thumbs up and all of those things. And do let me know your thoughts on all of this in the comment below. And of course, a special thanks to KDAP, who is providing the time for recording and preparing these videos.
Wait, there's more. On June 13th to 15th, KDAP is going to host a Qt developer conference in Berlin, in person. I'll be there, and I hope you'll be there too. Check out the program below. Trust me, there is going to be something super interesting for widgets developers too.